A global epidemic is unfolding before us. If we don't do anything about it, more than 10 million people will die by 2050. That's almost the entire population of Chennai and Kolkata combined. Imagine for a moment that you're down with fever and the doctor prescribes an antibiotic course. Say it's important for you to finish the course and that you don't take any other medicine in this time. If you don't stick to these rules, some of the bacteria become overexposed to the medicines or exposed to smaller doses. And that's an opportunity for the bugs to develop resistance. Another way this resistance develops is through horizontal gene transfer, where bacteria acquire genes from other bacteria that give them the ability to survive the effects of certain antibiotics. Suddenly, you can't undergo medical procedures like chemotherapy, organ transplants, or joint replacements. Because if an infection of antibiotic-resistant bacteria kicks in, it's going to be really hard to get rid of it. In many ways, this could take us back to the pre-penicillin era, when the world's average life expectancy was in the 30s and lower in the poorer countries.
The first patient to ever be treated with an antibiotic was a policeman in Oxford. On his day off from work, he was scratched by a rose thorn while working in the garden. That small scratch became infected. Over the next few days, his head was swollen with abscesses, and in fact, his eye was so infected that they had to take it out. A small team of doctors led by Dr. Howard Florey had managed to synthesize a very small amount of penicillin, and within 24 hours, he started getting better. This was a miracle. Day 5, they ran out of penicillin, and the poor man died.
The discovery of penicillin in the late 1920s revolutionized medical treatment. But for how long will its effects last? Various bacteria and other pathogens have always been evolving to resist antibiotics. But there was always a stronger drug to counter the stronger bug. But of late, the pace at which scientists have been discovering new antibiotics has plummeted, even as the use of antibiotics has turned into abuse. According to a report published by CDEP, there has been a 62% increase in India's use of antibiotics between 2001 and 2010. In this time, the world's use of antibiotics climbed by a relatively smaller 36%. So while antibiotic resistance is a global phenomenon, the Indian situation calls for a red alert. One reason for this is the rampant use and over-the-counter sale of antibiotics. A report published in February this year by the British Journal of Clinical Pharmacology said that over 64% of antibiotics sold in India between 2007 and 2012 were not approved by the Central Drug Standard Control Organization. In India, colistin, which is a high-grade antibiotic, is being administered to animals for promoting growth. The Bureau of Investigative Journalism published a report earlier this year that showed at least 5 major pharmaceutical companies advertised colistin as a growth promoter in India. Venky's, which is India's largest poultry and non-veg food producer, supplied colistin to farmers for growth promotion. These chickens could be spreading drug-resistant bacteria through the food chain in India. The resistance to colistin is called mobilized colistin resistance. At the Falling Walls conference held in Berlin in 2017, Timothy Walsh, a professor of microbiology and antibiotic resistance at Cardiff University, delivered a lecture on superbugs. He said that around 200 million Indians carry MCR1 within them as normal flora.
We've kind of been very myopic and very US-centric, very EU-centric in the way in which we go about our work. And so therefore, we've kind of not really looked at the broader issues, and the broader issues are things like poverty, things like sanitation, and indeed corruption, which are all linked to AMR.
He named the bacteria after India's capital, calling it New Delhi Metallobeta lactamase.
Where is NDM1 now? So this is kind of the countries, the map of where NDM1 has spread all over the world, and it's almost done it in real time. You can see that India and Pakistan are still the epicenter, but almost in real time it spread very quickly around the world.
The Indian government was upset by this and banned the export of all samples that Walsh needed from India for his study. In an interview to The Hindu, Walsh said he doesn't see antibiotic resistance in India happening through food, but through the environment. His research in Karachi proved so, and he said that Karachi's case could easily be extrapolated to Delhi, Mumbai and Kolkata. The claim that environment pollutants like factory wastes in India are full of resistant bacteria was proved to be true by a UK-based research organization called Changing Markets. They revealed that pharmaceutical industries in Hyderabad are dumping toxic pollutants into their surroundings.
If you have concentrations of antibiotics or antibiotic residues in water, which also contain bacteria, you know, naturally occurring environmental bacteria, exposure to these antibiotic residues, development of drug resistance in these bacteria. And so that's a major concern because of the other factors that are also fueling drug resistance.
According to Ramanan, what's worse is that even seemingly hygienic hospitals in India are infested with antibiotic-resistant superbugs.
There is practically no hospital in India which does not have not just hospital pathogens, but without serious amounts of hospital pathogens. So it is only a question of who's telling the truth versus not. It is not a question of, you can have very high-level doctors showing up in their full scrubs on national television saying, oh, we've never seen a hospital infection. They are lying. There is no hospital in India without hospital infection.
The sad truth is that even as we speak, hundreds of people are dying because of antibiotic resistance, but their death certificates won't mention this.
Hospitals are reluctant to tell anyone that A, they have a problem with resistant pathogens, or second, to even say that a patient died because of a resistant pathogen, because then they would be blamed for it. This is a common phenomenon in many Indian hospitals. But the death certificate, the discharge certificate will all say multi-organ infection or multi-organ failure. Might not even mention the word infection.
In 2016, at the World Economic Forum in Davos, 85 pharma companies and 9 industry associations from 18 countries signed a declaration to voice their support for innovations that will assist in preventing drug-resistant infections. There were 3 Indian companies, Wockhardt, Cipla and Vitas. They were a part of this declaration, but innovation alone won't be enough. On the one hand, the Indian government has been hostile towards those who only want to help. On the other hand, the declaration mentions that Indian companies will support innovations and curb antibiotic resistance. Sandwiched between the rock and the hard place are the lives of millions of Indians.